Sometimes the best way to understand a historic moment is to be there yourself. So let's go back. The year is 2004, MySpace is the biggest social media site, YouTube doesn't exist, and neither do smartphones. At this point, the internet is getting regularly available, and more users are logging on, browsing the web, shopping, and getting involved in communities. And while this may be a reflection of how the internet is often used today, 2004 was still the Wild West when it came to the introduction of new ideas. You see, when summer of 2004 rolled around, Bungie was hard at work completing the final touches on the highly anticipated game Halo 2, and fans from the first game would eagerly await for any type of news, trailer, or development update that could potentially shed more information on the game and its secrets. So it's no surprise when, in an unprecedented event, when a new Halo trailer revealed a secret website link, Halo fans would flock to the website in hopes of finding more information about the game. But instead of some new juicy info on Halo 2, fans would be brought to an odd website all about beekeeping. And at first glance, there was nothing out of the ordinary, just a regular blog, right? Well, if you looked at the site with a closer eye, you would start to realize something wasn't quite right. Someone or something had gained access to the back end of the website and was leaving cryptic messages that puzzled website visitors. And as it would turn out, even before the Halo 2 trailer, a smaller community of non-Halo users had already stumbled upon this website and was already working at trying to figure out this odd mystery. So what was going on here? Did this website even have anything to do with beekeeping in the first place? Some people even thought that the inclusion in the Halo 2 trailer could have been an oversight by Microsoft. Could this have been something more involved than what it looked like on the surface? Today, we are looking at one of the most unique stories that occurred within the Halo community just prior to Halo 2's release. This is the story of I Love Bees. Now, I Love Bees is really in a unique category, as from what we can understand, this occurrence is often just quickly summarized and tossed aside as a small blip on the legacy that Halo is known for. And when you go through and you read a summary of the event, or just listen to some of the audio files that came out of it all, it honestly doesn't nearly do justice for the complexity and the significance of the I Love Bees occurrence. So, to best understand I Love Bees, and to highlight the monumental role that this thing played, we are going to go back to where it all started and stitch together this mystery one by one, just as if we were all beekeepers back in 2004. So to fully understand everything, we're going to need to start at the very beginning, July 16th, 2004. Our story begins in the summer of 2004, when the admin, Steve Peters, of the website ARGNet, received a strange FedEx package in the mail. Now back in 2004, Steve Peters was a very involved member within several alternate reality gaming communities online. Not only had he written his own fan puzzle ARG in the past, but he also had created ARGNet as a platform to document new happenings within the growing genre. So when Steve received a package in the mail, he was quick to write a blog post to his followers about the odd contents that were discovered upon opening the package. Steve found himself with multiple honey bottles that all had letters inside of them. Now, Steve, with his prominent background in the ARG space, likely concluded that this was an ARG, or alternate reality game, which is essentially a fictional game that some people could interact with to reveal a larger story. But never had Steve gotten something like honey bottles in the mail with random letters in it. Upon the mess that would have been opening up the bottles to get the letters out, he laid out the different letters. O, I, V, E, E, S, B, L, E. It was an anagram, and after rearranging the letters, the sentence that formed was I love bees. So, going onto the internet where he supposedly decided to try to figure out what this could be, he stumbled upon the website ilovebees.com. Probably wasn't too hard to actually figure out that that would be the right website for it. And when he found the website and the oddities that were going on this website day one, he decided to make a post about it to his community, which was a smaller, tight-knit community who were interested in the ARG genre. Now, if you look for the website today, it no longer exists, but fortunately enough, one community member who went by The Bruce managed to make a mirror version of the website that still exists today at ilovebees.co. Actually, matter of fact, The Bruce helped us out with a lot of information and his own personal experiences as he was there during this search, so having the firsthand accounts was really helpful in trying to break down what exactly happened with this occurrence. Now, as members of the ARGNet community began to trickle over to this mysterious I Love Bees website, it honestly looked like an ordinary bee and honey website, but there were definitely a few odd nuances along the way. Had this website been hacked? While there were definitely pages that looked like how a regular website like this would look in 2004, there were these oddities with it, like this weird pop-up message. There were various countdown timers, one for just in 11 days and another one that was a little further down the road. And the more various people looked at this website, the more it seemed like it was alluding to some kind of physical awakening in some way or manner. As some of these earliest users dug a little further through the site, some pages would have corrupted images, while others would have these odd Mayday messages which appeared as if someone was in distress or trying to use this website as a means to reach people. Now, the first thing that these earliest people did was to look up who the domain ilovebees.com was registered to, and upon looking this information up, the site was registered to a Margaret Effendi with a phone number listed. Some people would even go as far as calling the phone number, which led to a voicemail of someone named Dana, not Margaret. There was also an email on the site listed as ladyb777@hotmail.com. You know, back when people actually used Hotmail as an email provider. Now, this website was kind of based off of Margaret's Honey, which seemed to be the brand of honey that this site was promoting, and it was the same type of honey that Steve had gotten in the mail. But it wasn't too long before some of the readers on the website were able to realize that one of the admins who ran the website had posted a specific message to the newer readers coming to the website with a specific link to their personal blog. And as it turns out, this admin of the I Love Bees website was actually the niece to Margaret and the webmaster who had set up the website I Love Bees for her aunt. And her name, of course, was Dana. Now, if users would click through the I Love Bees website and make their way to the separate blog website, we would be introduced to the voice of Dana, who ended up being the most crucial part of this entire occurrence. Her post on her blogspot said, "You're reading this, so I'll assume you've already witnessed the damage over on my aunt's website. That's how you got here, right? Unless your Google search included terms like honey, SOS, and WTF. Now I'm actually curious to see what turns up. Okay, focus, Dana. I've been wrestling with the site's bugs myself since late last week. I've exhausted every strategy I can think of, scoured my code, ran virus checks, did the whole spyware spy hunter thing, installed all the browser updates, and then finally just wiped the site and rebuilt it from scratch. Nothing helped. In fact, although I might be just hallucinating from too much mate, I would swear it's getting worse. I'm posting all of the original pages below so you can see what ilovebees.com looked like before it crossed over to the dark side." She also would go on to mention that she was getting ready for a trip to China, and she had up a timer on the website that was seemingly the same timer that ended up getting hijacked and changed. In this case, the blogspot page had comments enabled, so many people from the ARGNet community began communicating, trying to help Dana figure out what on earth was going on with her site. The investigation continued, and some users noticed that the text that would pop up randomly could also be tied together to maybe some text that was hidden in the source code of the webpage. As there was other text that was hidden in the keywords in the JavaScript, it started to become apparent that as more people looked through the website, there was some sort of message trying to be conveyed. And after a little bit of searching, a fourth set of text would be discovered in a pretty unusual place. Now, looking through the site, you can see it looks pretty scuffed. Besides the major visual errors and other weird stuff, you might notice that some of these images are straight up broken. However, if you were to download these images and then try to open them up, some might open, but others would actually be a corrupt file. However, if you open them up in a text editor, the readers on the I Love Bees website found that these phrases could actually line up together to reveal a secret message. So slowly, by using the words from the different sections hidden on the site and the corrupted pictures, things started to come together, and the users collectively worked together to try and piece whatever dialogue was presented presenting itself on the website. It wouldn't take long for the discussions of what was going on with I Love Bees to span a little bit further than just the first initial community that dropped on the website. There were forum posts on websites like Unfiction and other places where people discussed what was going on in this odd occurrence. Now, at this point, there were kind of two different messages that were being presented through the website that readers were able to decode. One of them was this odd fairy tale type parallel about some sort of widow struggling to return her queen to a throne, and the queen was hit by an enchantment, but it was told in this odd perspective of a flashback of someone who dreamed up the story, but we never get their name. However, this story did introduce something very crucial for the rest of the I Love Bees occurrence. There's four different characters in it: the widow, the queen, the sleeping princess, and the pious flea. I know, if you're like me, you have no idea what that means. And honestly, we'll do our best to explain it when it becomes relevant. But just remember in the back of your head that this was something that happened early on in this occurrence, way back before any of the Halo involvement decided just to break through the door. Then the other text that was very commonly found on the website were those texts that started off the messages with the phrase "Mayday, Mayday, Mayday." Oddly enough, it followed some sort of possibly computer program that sounded as if they were stranded or shipwrecked somewhere and they were being tortured by spiders. Once again, this thing randomly appears on various pages and almost all start off with that Mayday phrase, but the community was starting to see that this story is definitely much deeper than what you would have seen if you just logged in for the first time. Tuesday, August 24th, 2004. Dana decided to update her blog once again after the community had decoded the secret messages. Tries to stop thinking about it. Time for some updates. Aunt Margaret wants you to know how touched she is by the flood of support we've gotten on the blog and via email. So touched that she wants to mix a new flavor of honey in honor of you guys, a black button sage variety, but I'm not sure she knows what to call it yet. Warm fuzzies aside, the hijacked countdown has definitely gotten under Aunt M's skin. Strong intrusive inclination gives her the heebie-jeebies, and those are her words. She asked me if the medium will metastasize means that her computer is going to explode. I'm pretty sure it doesn't, but unfortunately for now, I don't have a more optimistic interpretation to offer her. I hate that Aunt M is losing sleep over this, or that I am for that matter. I'd feel a lot more comfortable if I understood its motives better. At least I know from Mark that the image glitches are caused by embedded texts of origins unknown, not sure how they fit together. I'm guessing that from some of the emails I've received that at least a handful of you are chewing on this problem in real time somewhere. Is there a channel I can direct people to so they can sync up with you? P.S. A lot of you have sent emails asking for personal information that might be relevant to the problems as I Love Bees, and to be honest, I'm still figuring out how much I feel comfortable sharing at this point. I hope you can be patient with me. This was actually a really big deal when this post went live because this was the first time users saw some sort of a direct interaction with Dana, who was actively also investigating the oddities of her website. Now, of course, responding to Dana's requests, users set up a channel called Beekeepers on an IRC.chat solutions site. They also had communicated on the forum Unfiction, which was used pretty heavily to archive information in the earliest days. At this point, the Beekeepers were getting ready, but I don't think anyone fully anticipated what would come next and how drastic and crazy this rabbit hole would end up going. July 20th, 2004. Users who had emailed ladyb777@hotmail.com, which was that email address linked on the website in the first day when they looked up the domain name, would receive a very strange email back. "Keep me. Odd behavior, cry for help. I'm using it to make some of the messages, have ever put together some of the messages. Just wanted to say that I'm not odd behavior, but I danger a voodoo witch that runs smear into the web, the forte, including the any enemies. I am sorry, just wanted to say. I'm not much of an expert, but I wanted to find out more about ordering some of the messages, the forte. I can see the forte. Problem, quite interesting. No idea who I'm part of. Have any enemies? Voodoo witch, voodoo parents, voodoo witch that runs into the web, voodoo parents wanted to cover all my together, a home, the forte, a voodoo parents of mine, voodoo parents keep me. I wanted to find out if there's anything I can do. Problem, quite interesting, time of need. I wanted to say that I'm using it, some of the messages be some kind of cry for help. And if there's warning voodoo parents of cry for help, voodoo parents wanted to cover all my odd behavior into the web. And if you check it, might be some kind kind of seductive danger to get many people angry, but I wanted to find all these people willing to help. Very nice problem, quite interesting, love. Beekeepers on the IRC chat quickly realized that not only does this email not make sense, but also realized that the string of words were taken from the emails that they had originally sent to Lady B early on, before anyone knew who Dana was or that there was a blog to begin with. Weird. Now, some had speculated that maybe Margaret was losing her mind, and others speculated that maybe something worse was going on. Meanwhile, while all of this was going on, Microsoft announced that a new trailer which would show off some of the Halo 2 gameplay would be releasing soon. Matter of fact, the trailer would release exclusively in Lowe's movie theaters for 1 week before the video would be put online for the world to see. But then, at the very end of the trailer, as we pointed out earlier on, the website at the bottom for one brief moment glitched out and changed to ilovebees.com before correcting itself. Now, of course, it's pretty obvious that this was an intentional thing to drive more people to this ARG, but the scale and absolute chaos that would ensue in the following weeks was definitely something bigger than anything like this that has ever happened before, and this was only the beginning. During the first week, fans who caught the trailer in theaters and managed to remember the website through the length of the movie would head home and jump onto the website that was definitely rather odd and potentially hiding encrypted messages. Even more interesting at this time, the smaller group of people who had trickled in from Steve Peters' first encounter with I Love Bees and the ARGnet realized that this small little bee mystery wasn't just a regular ARG. This was something related to Halo. The Halo. This was one of the first times some sort of alternative reality game was being used for a video game like this, but if I Love Bees is actually about Halo, what on earth is going on here? And why would a website about bees have someone hijacking it? Various members from ARGnet or the Halo forums would really converge during this time throughout the internet in an attempt to try to piece together as to what this website could really be about. Not only would the beekeepers be shocked about the Halo connection and the fact that they'd been searching for clues this whole time not realizing it was a part of Halo, but they also realized how massive this thing would be. And there was an overwhelming amount of new users trickling into the website, and once the trailer would go live for everyone, this small mystery would hit levels of craziness that no one had ever seen before. Now, some of the new people were angrily posting on the I Love Bees website, not understanding what or how an alternate reality game worked. There still were many people who became enthusiastic about the discovery that the beekeepers had made so far, and they spent their time after watching that first trailer reading through the discussions and summaries that the original beekeepers had made to get caught up on the progress in this mystery. There's still a lot to uncover, and a lot more people would be flooding in the site soon, and practically overnight, the main chats, forums, and wikis had hundreds of new members posting their own theories. Some would even provide valuable background into the Halo lore, which was something that the original beekeepers likely didn't have the most knowledge on, and, you know, other new people who'd come to the forums were kind of toxic. And then to top this all off, besides the chaos of all of the new users coming in, Dana confirmed in her next blog post that the strange email that people had gotten the day earlier, yeah, Margaret never sent it. Woke up Tuesday to an alarming email from Aunt Margaret. Apparently, so did a few of you, as evident by the many, "I think your aunt has completely lost it" messages I received. It took several hours to finally get a hold of Aunt M on the phone. Before I could say a word about the odd behavior cry for help, she had her own email question for me. Did I have any idea why all her hotmail would disappear overnight? I logged in as LadyB777 to check out the damage. The old password worked fine, but there was no mail in any of the folders. Weird. I wrote a quick test message and sent it off to myself. Nothing shows up in my Gmail inbox. I tried again, and this time to an older account. I checked there. Nothing. Again, rinse, repeat. Nothing. It's like a little Maxwell's demon siphoning off all ingoing and outgoing messages, and apparently sending out its own. So Aunt Margaret's email appears to have gone the way of the China countdown. Hijacked. Were repurposed. My first instinct, ask Hotmail to kill the account entirely. But then someone calling him, her, self, XN Bomb, sent me a very persuasive email that made me rethink things. Read for yourself. It seems snippets of various emails that have been sent to you by my colleagues have been reassembled and sent back, apparently originating from your aunt's Hotmail address. I'm not really sure what it means at this point, but it tells us that we can communicate with these entities using email. In the absence of having a clear idea of just what is going on, the first priority is to communicate. That is how we can learn more. It's at least possible that we've stumbled across across something extraordinary here, and our first priority must be to learn all we can about it. It's for that reason I'm going to suggest that you take no further action that interferes with what's going on at ilovebees.com. There's another reason too, one slightly more disturbing. Consider this passage from the end of the tale hidden in the images. The day will break and the sun will rise when the queen returns to rule, and further let it be known that retribution on any who hinder the return of the queen will be swift and terrible. This is a significant warning, namely that any interference with that process will be regarded as a hostile act. I don't know what the spider is capable of, but I'm not sure I want to find out. Dana would continue her post saying that she decided to try to shield her aunt from the latest developments and told her that it was just a widespread Hotmail glitch. But the next things that came up in this I Love Bees arc were pretty bizarre. Things actually went from interesting to straight up intrusive for Dana just shortly after the post was made. A blog post on July 27th marked the biggest update from Dana yet, where she said she felt like she was being watched through her webcam. Matter of fact, the website would update with new images spread throughout the site, some titled things such as killer.jpg. Some of these images would be corrupted with text hidden away like before, and the text that was recovered seemed to be this odd question and answer type thing between the queen and the spider. But the creepiest thing was when, after removing the text from the corrupted images and resaving it, restoring the image, we could see the pictures of Dana's webcam and her kind of freaking out that she was being watched. But then one of the biggest puzzles would be dropped on the website that was definitely much more involved than just picking apart text from a picture file. But with things starting to get more aggressive and the stakes starting to feel higher, the beekeepers were introduced to a new puzzle that not only would be one of the most challenging things they had faced so far, but would also be integral to revealing what was going on in the background and where this mystery and story was headed. Essentially, what happened was, in an update to the website, on 15 different pages, there were a list of website links posted literally all over the place. And in total, there were 300 different websites that were now linked on the I Love Bees website. The beekeepers actually had to go to every single link and try to compare which phrases existed on multiple websites for each group of links on I Love Bees and take those similar phrases and put them together to solve some sort of story. And while that sounds incredibly complicated, the community working together was able to figure out what phrases on each website were the same, and slowly but surely, they were able to spell out the next piece of this story, which was a really big deal because for the first time, we were getting a look behind the curtain as to what was going on the computer and what is happening in this really odd story. The link puzzle actually slowly revealed a monologue by a computer AI character called the Operator, who also sometimes goes by Melissa. She found herself stuck in a primitive server, the one that hosted the I Love Bees website, and her mind seemed fragmented. As it would turn out, she was the one that used the webcam to see Dana and identified Dana as the one who caused the damage to her. Meanwhile, an executable file known as a spider, or SPDR, which also gets referred to from time to time as a widow. But as it would turn out, this spider was a protocol that came with AIs, with its main responsibility to fix an AI if it is broken or is fragmented. And while the spider is working on repairing the AI of Melissa, apparently it was causing some deep memories to be activated again within Melissa. In this short monologue we got, we didn't get too many details, but at least this was presented and hinted at, which would play a major role later on. This discovery, of course, did not sit well with Dana. I mean, can you blame her? She made a brief post explaining she was leaving the site and didn't want to deal with any of this. She already had her trip planned out, and she wasn't really liking the idea of an AI or a Melissa or a computer, whatever it was, trying to target her. So, just like that, Dana left the site and vanished, likely going on her trip to China that she had already planned out, maybe leaving a little early just to get away. During the next few weeks, the beekeepers would see a few odd occurrences, things some people didn't expect at all. Matter of fact, some Halo fans were shocked with how much depth this quote-unquote simple marketing ploy ended up having. Firstly, that Lady Bee email that was associated with the site would send an email out to the beekeepers again, and though just as cryptic as before, Lady Bee was now referring to herself as the princess and alluded to being an ally to Dana of all things, and that there was an importance to her role, meaning she would need to come back. The beekeepers would send email after email to Dana encouraging her to return until she finally made her return at least somewhat, to the community after everyone had really voiced their concern. In Dana's return, she would respond with just a simple update, still keeping a distance for the time being, but at least the beekeepers weren't in the dark from Dana anymore. The site would be updated again, this time revealing more corrupted images and audio files that, to this day, are pretty creepy to listen to. But those dates that were alluded to on the website were still counting down, and from the beginning, August 24th, 2004, had a countdown leading up to something, but no one fully knew what to expect. With Halo 2 still not set to release until the fall, many players suspected that this whole thing was built by Bungie and Microsoft to get an early demo disc of Halo 2. More and more beekeepers continued to join the cause through word of mouth and discussions on other sites. Hype was real for Halo 2, and people wanted to get to be the select few to have a shot at playing Halo before its launch. But with a week to go before that mysterious August 24th date, some more odd occurrences were happening on the website. More and more clues were being dropped in the website updates, with more text hidden in images or site code to crawl through. While during the earlier weeks we had learned a little bit as to what was going on within the server of I Love Bees, this period before this big reveal was crucial. Through the work of decoding cryptic puzzles that the community collectively solved, several haikus were put together from a perspective of something called the flea. What? Okay, at this point, it seems like there's so many different elements and different names for characters on this computer, it was really easy to get lost. Fortunately enough, there were so many guides online teaching people and showing people the way to figure out who was who in the story. So before things get any more complex, let's just go over all the characters and the multiple pseudonyms that they all seem to have. Let's also try to catch up to everything that's happened on in the story so far as well. Okay, so earlier we learned of an AI named Melissa, who showed up on the I Love Bees server. Melissa is sometimes referred to as the Queen, and also the operator. She's really mad, she's stuck in the server, she can't remember anything, and for whatever reason, she thought Dana was the enemy. Then we have the princess, which seems to update the sites periodically, typing as a child, and also seems to be whatever sent out that email from the Lady Bee email address. It was weird, but we know that the princess at least sees Dana as an ally. Then we have the spider, or the widow, which is some sort of protocol that's been repairing Melissa's memory since her appearance in the server. And lastly, we have the flea, which, to our understanding, might actually be some sort of virus that is being hunted by the spider. In the haikus that were decoded during this time, it alluded that Melissa may be regaining access to blocked off memories with the help of the flea. During the last days as the spider hunted the flea, beekeepers could track the progress by following the site's corruptions and trying to correctly follow the trails, which could lead to restoring fragments of Melissa's memory in text form. Finally, after all of this time, we got a little glimpse into how this all could link into the Halo universe. We learned that Melissa was this AI, and in a brief flashback, we see that Melissa is alongside a Captain Green and a Lieutenant Sorensen. While they're out in space, they find an odd cylinder-shaped artifact, and they assume it's probably something that would be important to the Covenant if they were the ones to discover it first. And as they begin to examine it closer, Melissa begins to feel odd. She wonders if maybe there's a virus from the Covenant that's attacking her. And that ends the flashback. It wasn't much, but we're starting to realize this is a much larger bridge that might not only reveal to us some Halo 2 stuff, might even expand the Halo lore even more. Could this be something larger than just Halo 2? While that question concerned some, the attention was starting to be pulled away and redirected at something else, something bigger. By August 17th, just 1 week before this big mysterious event, websites would update again. This time, the links section of the site would have a list of over 220 different GPS locations with different times on them all, dated for August 24th, 2004, along with a message, "Axons go hot." The general consensus is that while no one knew what exactly to expect in all this, many believed it was intended that the beekeepers would be expected to go to these locations of the Axons to reach a conclusion to the story. Many believed this would be where Bungie and other Halo representatives would gift players with that much sought after Halo 2 demo. Maybe the site would be updated and tell some sort of interesting story. And after all the puzzles, all the work that the community put in together, was the end end finally in sight, it'd be amazing to see all the people who worked at decoding this ARG come together and get that cool prize. Well, when August 24th came, beekeepers across the United States traveled to their nearest location at the set time, with some locations having as many as 30 or 50 or more people gather. This was a huge deal, and people were invested and excited. In the location with the earliest scheduled time, beekeepers were ready for Halo 2 demo or whatever it would be, but instead they got something quite different that ended up happening. At each of the locations at the designated time, a payphone would ring. Yeah. All along these 220 different GPS locations across the country, they were all just coordinates to, of all things, payphones. Yeah, I guess this was 2004. Upon answering the phone, Melissa would ask a few questions, where beekeepers would have to answer the questions correctly, such as saying what Melissa's name was, or whatever code word that had been discovered on the website side of things. This wasn't the end of the ARG, as many thought. This was just the beginning. Now, for brevity's sake, I'll do my best to explain briefly how this phase of the ARG would work. Essentially, once these went online, the website would update once or twice a week with a list of coordinates and times that the payphones would ring. Beekeepers would need to work together across the US and even a few phone booths in London to activate all of the axons. If done correctly, progress would be made in the ARG, and over the course of the next few weeks, all of the beekeepers collectively would have to successfully activate 777 axons to reveal the whole story. Or in other words, they'd answer 777 payphones to get the entire story revealed. And as progress would be made towards that giant 777 number goal, there would be little thresholds along the way, which when reached, several audio files would be updated and released on the website. Now, these audio files were in random order, and by piecing the files together in the right order, beekeepers would be able to listen in to an audio drum, something that Halo had never done prior to this event. Much like Hunt the Truth in Halo 5 or Sadie's story in ODST, these audio files would actually tell three unique stories, all taking place within the Halo universe. Now, even with the beginning intentions of the ARG starting to come together, the quest for completion was just as cryptic as ever. Not only were there a lot of puzzle solving involved just to figure out the coordinates as to which payphones would activate an axon, but then after thresholds were met and audio files were dropped, were just small snippets without any obvious clue as to which order they were intended to be listened to in. So while the beekeeping community had grown into this hive of players with people all over the US looking for payphones to activate, there was also another significant portion of players who would work the intel side of the mystery by decoding the GPS coordinates to help people figure out where the closest ones were and which ones they needed. Then they also had to take these audio files and try to organize them in a way that a story could make sense. Remember, the audio drama was three separate character stories, and it could get really confusing. I actually got a chance for this video to talk to The Bruce, who's one of the very prominent members back in 2004 involved in trying to solve the I Love Bees mystery. It took a little digging to actually find him, but once I found an active email address, I reached out to him, and he was incredibly helpful with filling in the gaps to a lot of the steps and featured that everyone was involved in that were kind of lost to time. While doing research on this video, a lot of websites aren't really around anymore. So fortunately enough, the Bruce helped guide me with a lot of resources that were incredibly helpful. Now, during the big payphone search, the Bruce, or Jeff, was living in Canada and didn't have access to any of the axons, as none were in Canada due to Bell owning the payphones in Canada and not being able to receive incoming calls. So, much like a lot of the community that weren't near any of the active accents, Jeff ended up working alongside other community members every time there was an update to quickly try to crack all of the GPS coordinates and piece together the story so that the other people who were nearby were able to help in the ways that they could. They actually used a wiki called The Fireflies, where users would work together to be the spot for the most up-to-date info in this whole search. It definitely was really cool because this allowed for users to work together and solve stuff as efficiently as possible. Each week for the next few weeks, the website would update and new GPS coordinates would need to be decrypted, which would in turn reveal even more of the story. Now, we aren't going to include all of the audio drama, but we will do a rough run through of what essentially happens in the audio drama story, as it reveals so much about the larger Halo universe. And honestly, this is something that was incredibly cool to listen to all this time later. They're on YouTube. You should check them out if you guys are interested in them. them. 42 Entertainment, the company that produced the audio drama, actually encouraged beekeepers to distribute the stories digitally. And while this is actually just an audio story, there's no visuals associated with it, I decided to make my own scuffed visuals in Photoshop. So while we recap what happened in the audio side of I Love Bees, you can enjoy these scuffed visuals as well. So this is the story that would be revealed in the following weeks as players answered those payphones and new accent thresholds were progressively fulfilled. So things would kick off in the year 2537, 15 years before the events of Halo Combat Evolved occurred. 6-year-old Yasmin Zaman was forcibly kidnapped and replaced with a clone so that she could be inducted into the second class of the Spartan 2 program. After 8 years of training to become a Spartan during the augmentation period, Yasmin's body would reject the augmentation and she would in result die. And with funding running out for the Spartan 2 program and the limited number of candidates remaining, the second class of the Spartan 2 project, led by Catherine Halsey, would end up being scrapped altogether. However, despite Yasmin washing out during the augmentation process, her brain would be flashed and used to create a smart AI named Melissa, and years later would be assigned to the UNSC Apocalypso. While receiving a transmission with details of a Covenant attack, a Trojan AI spy called the Seeker would infiltrate, which began to cause parts of Melissa to corrupt. Realizing that something was wrong, Melissa would warn the captain, but while on the way back home, the ship would encounter a Forerunner object, unlike anything they had discovered before. After bringing the artifact on board the Apocalypso to bring back for investigation, the AI spy used its infiltration within Melissa to actually entice a crew member to interact with the artifact while the Apocalypso was in slipspace, causing the whole ship to not only fall out of slipspace, but also for all communication in the entire solar system to deactivate for about 7 seconds. With this crazy explosion or occurrence happening in slipspace and Melissa's corruption getting worse, the explosion somehow caused Melissa to be fragmented and blown apart, with some of her fragments being thrown back in time approximately 550 years earlier, where she would become trapped in the primitive server that was hosting a website called I Love Bees. Now this is the point where we start to get an explanation as to what was going on earlier on the website. On the website side of things, the AI Melissa is kind of super corrupted with multiple versions of herself fragmented. First, we have the fragment of Melissa that contained the subconscious memories of a very young Yasmin who retains a sense of her memory much like how she was before she was kidnapped for the Spartan program. This is why we were getting some of the whole sleeping princess stuff and childlike talking that would show up on the website from time to time. There was another fragment known as the Operator, which was more of the standard military AI Melissa. However, she does not have any memory and acts out nearly violently trying to make sense of what's going on. She was actually the one who hijacked the site and targeted Dana in the first place. Then, with the AI programming, there is a protocol called a System Peril Distributed Reflex, or SPIDER for short, which is typically used to repair and restore AIs if something like corruption occurs. The SPIDER begins to try to run its protocol on the Operator, or Melissa, and Melissa, not understanding, finds it to be a pretty unpleasant experience. And then that virus spy from the Covenant, the Seeker or whatever it was called, it's also in there as well. And in the confusion, it actually manages to convince the Operator, or Melissa, that it's actually the real spider and not the spider that had been working on her. And the Seeker ends up convincing the Operator to turn off the spider and let it work on her. While the other fragmented part of Melissa, the sleeping princess, refers to the Seeker as the fleet. So the Seeker ends up continuing the repairs on Melissa, but also begins to try to reprogram her as well along the way. The fragmentation containing Yasmin or the sleeping princess is kind of salty towards the Operator or Melissa and the Seeker, also known as the flea, as apparently they managed to have her locked away so she couldn't get involved in trying to interfere. But from time to time, she would manage to sneak out and communicate with the beekeepers by posting on the website as well. So while we have these four characters kind of floating on the I Love Bees server, there was actually another fragmented part of Melissa that did not get sent back to 2004, but still in 2552, landed in a home computer of a Jersey Morelli, with this version of Melissa also having no recollection of anything whatsoever. And Jersey, for whatever reason, decides to name this version Durga because he thinks it's a good fit. I don't know, this seems like the personality that we could expect from someone named Jersey. So while our boy Jersey has this super AI in his computer, he decides that he wants Durga to spy on the girl that he kinda likes, who is down the hall, named Jan. Kinda creepy, dude. But as it turns out, through Durga's spying, this Jan girl got a lot of stuff going on herself. She helped her friends break into a military base to return a gate pass that was stolen to steal a warthog. She also gets caught by a military police, and her father is mad at her, but doesn't want her to get in trouble, yada yada Yachty, so he ends up burning down the whole police station to get rid of some blood sample evidence. While this is all going on, she also saves a guy who was about to be murdered at a bar by some mobster that goes by Thin Kinkle. Seriously, what is that name? Damn. Durga, the fragment AI in the Halo timeline, also being bored with a bunch of the extra time she has doing nothing but spying on this girl down the hall, ends up spying on a medical student named Kamal. Now, Kamal isn't good with the ladies, so his mom sets him up on a date with some girl named Sophia. On their date, Sophia actually reveals she has a boyfriend named Aiden, and he's a gangster or something, and Kamal suspects, for whatever reason, Aiden, since he's a gangster, has gotta be cheating on Sophia, right? So he offers to hack Aiden's chatter so that he can reveal that Aiden is in fact cheating. And boom, right there and then, as it turns out, Aiden was actually on a date with someone else. So then these two, Kamal and Sophia, decide to come up with this ruse to publicly humiliate him. After all that, Kamal feels pretty good about himself. He hacked his way into the girl's heart, but then it turns out Sophia and Aiden end up getting back together, so that backfired pretty badly, and Kamal thinks he's gonna probably get killed by Aiden. He actually ends up getting a job offer from him instead. Also, since Durga is the super spy at this point, she also decides to spy on Oni officials, and she figures out that some colonel named Herzog may have actually known about the Covenant attack and just let the planets get glassed anyways. But then there's a new Oni recruit named Rainey who's looking for answers, but then someone tries to assassinate her, and Herzog turns out not to really be bad, but then dies in a hacked car accident before anyone finds out, and Rainey starts to feel like she's maybe been betrayed by Oni. So while all this is going on, it seems like Durga may still be somewhat connected with her other AI selves that are in 2004. The operator actually gets the audio recordings from when Durga was spying and doesn't really know what to think of them. She stores them aside, and the princess, or Yasmin, ends up using the audio files as leverage to the Seeker, who then learns about things in human emotion, something that really only Yasmin can teach, as she has memories of being a human. During all this, the beekeepers have been going around the country, answering phones, solving puzzles, and the operator seems to be trying to keep the princess locked up and away from the Seeker, and the beekeepers manage to free her from time to time. But things would take a pretty dramatic turn soon after. Back in the future, Kamal goes out to dinner with Sophia, just as friends though. He's still simping on her pretty hard at this point, but actually manages to open up a bit about his past, and as it turns out, he had a sister named Yasmin, who died when she was 6 years old to something called metabolic cascade failure, which resulted in him wanting to become a doctor. This is when we realize he was talking about the clone that replaced the original Yasmin, while the real Yasmin was kidnapped into the Spartan program, unbeknownst to him. Okay, so then that girl down the hall that Jersey wanted Durga to spy on, Jan, the one whose father burned down the entire police station, well, Durga continues spying on her, and later it's revealed that her father, Jim, was actually a member of the Orion Project, or the Spartan 1 Project. This was a program when they were first testing out augmentation on soldiers, but it was not nearly as invasive as the things we would see the official Spartan program, like we saw with the Spartan 2s, have to endure. Because of this, it turns out Jan also inherited some of the physical and mental augmentations from her father. They even later pay a visit to who would turn out to be Jan's mother, a woman named Gilly, who had psychological problems from also being a Spartan 1. It's a bit awkward. Matter of fact, Jan comes to find out that when she was an infant, her dad even had a medic inject her with Spartan-class serums, which ended up making it so that when Jan was growing up and Oni was looking for potential recruits for the second class of the Spartan 2 program, Jan, who was really good in school and exceeding in pretty much every category, caught the eye of Oni, and Jim was really paranoid, and he continuously and constantly moved his family in fear that she'd be abducted one day. Meanwhile, after helping with a few small projects, Kamal is now friends with gangster Aiden, who suggests they should clone pop stars and make money with public appearances. Kamal is at first like, heck no, but Aiden's like, please man, and Kamal caves. I mean, not really, but he agrees to at least do a study on clones and brings up problems with doing flash clones. They typically end up dying from something called metabolic cascade failure. Huh. Weird. That mobster guy from earlier, Thin Kinkle, somehow manages to kidnap Jan. Is kind of a jerk, using a device to torture her if she even thinks something bad about him, almost an attempt to induce Stockholm Syndrome. Her father comes to rescue her and gets shot and killed while they escape. Back on the 2004 Isle of Bees server, the sleeping princess realizes that the operator was hiding information about Oni Colonel Herzog from Durga because the operator had been reprogrammed by the Seeker. But since the sleeping princess, I guess, taught the virus empathy or something, something like that. The Seeker works to allow the operator to share this info back with Durga in 2552. Meanwhile, Kamal finds out that someone is spying on him, and while Aiden gets arrested and Sophia's fake visa gets canceled, Kamal, thinking Sophia ditched him, decides to look for Durga, as he suspects that this person that's spying on him must be responsible for kidnapping his sister. Little does he know that Durga is literally the loosest shell of what his sister once was. Jersey, on the other hand, meets up with Jan, who's mourning her dad's death, and tells her about Durga and all the info he was able to get on the mobster Thin Kinkle. She teams up with Durga and her Spartan One mom, Gilly, who comes to help, and they assault the mobster headquarters, and Gilly pretty much just kills everything so Jan didn't have to, so that was interesting. We also got to see Jersey talk to Durga about Kamal and realize that Durga used to be the sister of Kamal that was kidnapped. Durga ends up explaining that it's true, but also iterates that that's not who she is anymore, and she doesn't want to be Yasmin anymore. She also brings up how she's been having these odd memories coming from something that reminds her of a sleeping princess. She's been reliving in a dreamlike state from time to time. She's told how she's 7 years old, which is concerning because 7-year-old AIs are usually shut down by the UNSC before they end up going crazy in a state that's called rampancy. Matter of fact, she's so unsure what these dreamlike states that she's going in and out of really are that she's worried that maybe she's getting rampancy already. She actually puts Jersey in a tough spot and kind of says, hey, if I start going crazy because of my rampancy, it's time to shut me down. Jersey, of course, refuses because he's such a nice guy. But the big takeaway here is that this is some really cool rampancy story arc stuff coming up 8 years before Halo 4 ever really touched on the subject. I thought that was really cool. A little while later, we see Kamal show up at Jersey's apartment and starts asking about his sister. Jersey goes ahead and finally reveals Durga to him, and honestly, Durga just tells the truth that Yasmin is dead, and all she has is a copy of her personality. Kamal, however, insists, though, that Yasmin still kind of lives on through Durga, and since Durga's in this situation where rampancy might be coming sooner than later, he wants to help, as this would be a chance to help his sister in one way or another, because he wasn't there to help his sister when she was kidnapped. Meanwhile, Jan, after, you know, just killing all those gangsters or whatever, decides that she's going to just join the UNSC. She ends up getting denied because she's way too young, and while she's mad and yelling about it, talking to Jersey about it, Durga actually recruits her to break into the base that has that artifact that was recovered earlier, and they'd also team up with Kamal and Jersey, and the squad starting to come together. Durga even goes as far as getting Jersey to go and recruit Rainy, that one Oni person from earlier, and by getting to the artifact, this would help Rainy protect herself with Oni. Her storyline's kind of confusing, so we've kind of just rushed through it since it's not as important. The main takeaway is that we have an Oni agent, Rainy, from earlier, who's here, and she's willing to help them shut down the artifact. They all met at Jersey's place, and they come up with a plan on how they're going to break into the base and turn off that artifact. Back on the Isle of Bees side of things, the operator had once again found the sleeping princess and trapped her in the coating. The beekeepers worked relentlessly to help the Seeker of all things free her again, but it turned out to actually be a trap by the operator all along. The Seeker actually found out that the sleeping princess had been damaged and unable to run, so it absorbed her and transferred her into the operator, which formed a partial version of Melissa once again. We didn't expect this outcome to happen, but I guess murdering the princess ended up helping the cause. Wow. Melissa, who is starting to become more and more herself, reactivates the spider who kills the Seeker finally. It was a little bit crazy. It was like a massacre on Isle of Bees in just a short amount of time. So with now on the Isle of Bees server, all we have is Melissa and the spider who is finishing up the repairs on her. Melissa starts to organize a final task, and after all of the 777 payphones were activated, the end was finally in sight. Essentially, there were a few more axons that they would have to activate, but this time they had to do things differently. They had to take pictures with certain amounts of people in front of the payphones, which definitely was unique because they needed so many people at each location, which caused people to push out of their comfort zones and recruit just random people who were nearby a payphone to come close and get in the picture, because every person that was in the picture would contribute to the overall cause. Really unique, but it brought the story even further along. Durga and the rest of the group managed to find their way into the base, mostly undetected. They actually managed to get to the artifact, and they managed to activate or deactivate the artifact, which causes this huge slip space rupture type thing to happen, with another EMP cutting off all communication once again, and with this artifact getting deactivated, it caused whatever was holding those pieces of Melissa in 2004 to finally collapse, which caused all of the pieces to merge right there at that base, which reawakened Melissa's personality, with Yasmin's personality actually also coming more to the forefront as well. So finally, with Melissa back out of the Isle of Bees server and in 2552, all they have to do is escape. Durga manages to remotely cause a scorpion tank to blow a hole through the outer wall, and everyone manages to get away except Rainy, who gets captured by security, and kind of just everyone just moved on and forgot about her. The group would later come to find out that that artifact may have actually been something used as a remote that would potentially, or have the potential, to light all of the Halo rings simultaneously. So it's probably a good thing they managed to shut that thing off. So they all escape and live happily ever after, except Rainy. Well, sort of. Melissa ends up getting reassembled. Kamal and Sophie agree to get married, and Aiden, for whatever reason, is just cool with it. Jan decides to join up with some other Spartan ones and children of Spartan ones and become space pirates or something. I don't know, that was weird. And then Jersey is at home when Melissa reveals to him that she suspects the Seeker's intention, you know, that Covenant virus, the whole time was to reveal the location of the artifact, and it may have succeeded. In the distance, you can hear air raid sirens blaring, and it meant that the Covenant had located Earth. Now back on the Isle of Bees site with Melissa recompiled and back in the future, the Sleeping Princess was recompiled, the Seeker was dead, all that was left on the site was the Spider, who couldn't go back as it's just protocol. So since it's stuck there, unable to travel forward in time, it just decided to sit there and wait for 500 years to be used again. And it's cool with it. Just set up a timer, it's like, all right, 500 years, they'll get me. That's cool. I don't know, I think that's hilarious. But it would also be revealed that before Melissa left the site, the operator left a final message, which essentially was revealing a secret event that would occur in four different locations where any member of the Isle of Bees thing could go there, say the secret code word, and would be able to go to this all-inclusive Isle of Bees finale celebration type thing.
They just been a Halo 2 preview or even playing like they're doing right now.
They got DVDs of the audio story. Some of the cast members who voice acted the characters for the audio story were there. Some Bungie employees were there. And of course, they got to play Halo 2 before it released in a demo at the movie theaters. Now, of course, only four locations was pretty limited, but fortunately enough, across the US, they had a bunch of locations that would give out the DVDs at the very least with the code word. Most people ended up going to like a movie theater or something like that, going to the guest service section. They said the operator left you a message, and then boom, they were given the Isle of Bees DVD, which is actually one of the rarest pieces of Halo media that's out there right now. These things rarely go on sale online, so if you were lucky enough to be a part of it and you have one, kudos to you. They can run upwards from $2,500 or more. If anyone has an extra one, I would really appreciate it because I'd love to have it in my Halo collection. And finally, as for Dana, during the last few phases of the Isle of Bees story, she kind of took a step back from the main plot and just observed alongside the rest of the community. Of course, Dana ended up being an employee at 42 Entertainment, used to bring the story along, and kind of pivoted into more of a narrator role, where people who might not have followed the entire story thus far were able to get a recap through Dana's blog, kind of updating them on what's been discovered, who discovered stuff, and where this story is going. It was a really useful device, and it was something that was really cool. Now, some of the members of Isle of Bees really branched off and were able to do some really cool things, and the legacy of Isle of Bees was something amazing. Steve Peters, the guy who got the honey jars in the mail at the very beginning, ended up continuing being an ARG expert, and he was a writer as well, and even ended up working with 42 Entertainment on several ARGs in the industry after the events of Isle of Bees, and he also worked on his own. He's worked on projects like the Batman Dark Knight ARG, and also an ARG for Sea of Thieves, and many other ARGs. So it's cool that he kind of moved into the industry after the huge explosion of success that Isle of Bees was. The Bruce, or Jeff, the guy who we were able to reach out to and he helped us so much with this video, ended up loving the work he did figuring out the GPS coordinates, as he really loved the merged idea of a digital scavenger hunt with real world locations. And he actually runs a YouTube channel where he documents himself geocaching, which is where you use GPS coordinates to find real world locations and other special locations, and you interact with them along the way, and it's really cool. So at the end of this video, when we get to the end screen, we'll put one of his videos in there and you guys can check it out. Matter of fact, just a few years ago, Jeff and Steve Peters from ARGNet were on a panel together celebrating the 10-year anniversary of the Isle of Bees mystery, which is really cool and insightful also. So it's on YouTube if you guys want to take a listen to that. But this bigger story did so much for the Halo community. Now, some people question whether or not the story is canon, and Joseph Staden said on the Bungie forum way way back that bees probably wouldn't make the cut for canon status, but it seems like that decision would be changed shortly after. In 2006, Bungie and Microsoft work on taking the growing Halo universe and actually draw some defined lines as to what would be considered canon and what would not be considered canon. And they did this in honor of releasing the Halo graphic novel. And in the graphic novel, there's actually plot points, characters, and stories from I Love Bees that show up. Frank O'Connor, who was then working at Bungie, specifically mentioned I Love Bees as being canon and in the Halo universe. And there were a lot of really cool things that I Love Bees ended up contributing to future games in the Halo franchise. The communication kiosks that are all through New Mombasa in Halo 3 ODST, along with Opticon, were first mentioned in I Love Bees. Also, in the Halo Infinite trailer, during the boot up screen for the Gen 3 system, we actually see a spider being activated, which is the first appearance in the Halo universe since I Love Bees, which is an extremely exciting detail for a long forgotten Halo story. Bungie would actually team up with some of the writers from 42 Entertainment to implement another audio drama for Halo 3 ODST, Sadie's Story, which you have to find it somewhat ironic that to unlock Sadie's Story, we have to run around to payphones of all things on the streets of New Mombasa, just as players had to do in real life for I Love Bees. I think I Love Bees also played a major role in the underlying plot for Halo 3 ODST that is often overlooked. While we've been spending a lot of time looking at glyphs, symbols, and payphones, we've overlooked things that are actually very obvious, and just by digging in to the deeper corners of the Halo universe's lore, we can find a lot of really interesting things that could connect mysteries together in ways that we hadn't really thought about. We find out in other Halo material that the Prophet knowingly let Regret go to Earth during the events of Halo 2 as a part of his plan to kind of make Regret look bad for going to Earth without realizing that humans were there. And while we know that the Prophet of Regret found out about Earth from a luminary, the Prophet of Truth likely knew about the Earth's location ahead of time because of the artifact that went off at the end of I Love Bees, which is why Truth played this puppet master role, and it filled in some gaps of the story that we didn't get to really see fleshed out in either Halo 2 or Halo 3. But the artifact allowed Truth to be prepared to infiltrate, as we see him do in the secret legendary ending of Halo 3 ODST. Now, mind you, also in the ending, we see those glyphs from ODST in the background, which are not there just hours earlier when Alpha 9 rescues Virgil. So it's likely that these Hergox are marking something along the way while they're looking. And another side note, there's got to be something heavily coincidental about this level being called Data Hive and the cutscene also taking place in Data Hive. The name alone having a reference to bees should be enough to tip us off in places to look for I Love Bees seeping into the larger Halo universe. And I think it's just really clever that the final audio log is found on Data Hive and it has this connection to I Love Bees in the first place. We are getting really close to pointing our theories about ODST and those darn glyphs in the right direction. And we think we're onto something. We just need a little more time to piece it all together. And our Discord is a great place for discussion if you guys aren't already on there. Also, a huge shout out to CIA and the rest of the Halopedia community. There were so many valuable resources on the Halopedia site, along with links taking me to old archived stuff. And it really helped me discover everything I needed to break this down in a way that I could cover everything without this video being 15 hours long. This video took forever and a half to work on. The script was touching around 10,000 words, the most we've ever written for something like this. And we thought this would be a good opportunity to maybe reactivate our Patreon, which we never use. And if we can get some level of support on there, maybe we would be able to make bigger projects like this more often. And maybe we can hire on some extra help for editing and research, which would allow us to turn these types of videos around in a much faster manner. Our videos will always be free, but if you guys want to go there, get some cool perks, things on Discord, some behind the scenes stuff. If you can help Luke and I out with these projects, it definitely would mean the world to us.